Randomization is a key element in experimental design. It's extremely important. Now, one of the main objectives of randomization is a reduction of bias by ensuring that the groups, assuming, of course, that we're making comparison between a treatment group and a control group or a treatment and a placebo group, are similar to begin with. The randomization helps ensure that the groups are similar to begin with. Now, the key here is that it helps to ensure. It's no guarantee. Randomization also helps guard against unknown confounding factors in control versus experimental groups. A confounding factor, we sometimes refer to it as being a lurking factor or lurking variable. It's something that's hidden. It's a hidden factor that has a direct effect on whatever it is that we're trying to measure. That's what a confounding factor is. You got to watch out for those guys. They can really mess things up for you. As an example of a quick confounding factor, let's just say that we did something like this. We measured children's shoe size, and then we measured their reading ability. And we would find something amazing, that people with small feet have low reading abilities. People with larger feet have higher reading abilities. So if we were to plot the results, we would probably see something very linear. And the conclusion would be that people with bigger feet read better. Well, there's an obvious lurking variable, obvious confounding factor here. And that confounding factor is, in fact, age. Well, as kids get older, they go up in school. You know, so maybe we start off with first graders or kindergartners and then end up with sixth graders. Well, as they get older and they go up in levels in school, their reading ability, in theory at least, gets better. And what else happens? They grow. So the shoe size gets bigger. So of course you're going to see this. That's just a quick, kind of silly, but I think does rather well to illustrate the point of a lurking variable. Now, if we're talking about a cancer research as an example, it could be that you have a genetic predisposition that it doesn't matter what treatment you're going to get, that you're going to beat this cancer. Your body's going to beat it, so it doesn't really matter if you get the treatment or not. Or it could be it doesn't really matter what is done, that this cancer is going to kill you. It's just you're not going to survive. Well, there could be a lot of people with that genetic predisposition, but the researchers don't even know that genetic condition even exists. They're not even aware of it. So by randomizing who goes into which group, in theory, it should at least increase the probability that the equal number of people, roughly the equal number of people with a genetic predisposition to beat the cancer will be in each group. So the net effect will cancel each other out. So if there is a difference that is observed, it should be as a result of the treatment, not this confounding factor. So randomization helps that sort of a thing. It helps to reduce the effect of confounding factors that we don't even know exist. Now, here's an example of an observation study. It's a pediatric, and I always have a tough time pronouncing this word. It's something to the effect of coccidioidomycosis. It's valley fever. If you live in the San Joaquin Valley, then you're probably very familiar with the idea of what valley fever is. Kern County and the California San Joaquin Valley had a major coccidioidomycosis, valley fever epidemic from 1991 to 1993. During this period, 56 children, 33 males and 23 females with ages ranging from 3 months to 17 years were diagnosed and treated at the local county hospital. Analysis revealed that 50 cases had primary cocci, while 6 were disseminated, with 2 having meningitis, inflammation of the membranes of the brain or spinal cord, and 4 with osteococcidiomycosis, disseminated to the bones. The disease was predominant in Hispanic children, and 30 out of 56, which is 64%, versus non-Hispanic whites, 7 out of 56, 13%, compared to the hospital population of 48% Hispanics and 40% non-Hispanics. Now, that's just a part of the abstract for this research. This was an observational study. This was a situation where we actually went into medical records and pulled out the data and did the analysis on it. see here, this is observational because clearly we did nothing in this research to actually manipulate. It's not like we're given one kid this drug and that kid that drug to see how well it fights COXIE, how well it fights valley fever. Rather, we were just looking at medical records, looking for trends. Definitely observational, definitely retrospective.